Hello students, welcome all of you. Today I, Dr. Leena Khemchandani, Associate Professor and Academic Coordinator at Aryabhatta College, Ajmer, would like to discuss with you some very important concepts which are related to research methodology. So let's start. Basic terminology that we normally use in research. Research is basically a very common topic nowadays for every professional studies and more importantly for the management studies. So the first concept or the first topic of discussion would be research. What is research? A research is an organized set of activities that we can say that is a systematic approach, because we are taking step by step, we are going to study something to study and develop a model or procedure technique to find the results of a realistic problem supported by literature and data such that its objectives are optimized and further make recommendations for implementation. So there are various terms that I would like to make you understand. Number one, organized set of activities. This is a systematic approach. Research uses step-by-step procedure in order to study or to develop a model so that we can find out results and we can find out solutions for some realistic issues, some issues that we are facing in our daily life. Research is about that only, solving our realistic problems. And how we are going to solve the problem? We will support our research by way of literature. Literature means something which has been explored in the past, and the data we can draw from secondary sources also, as well as from the primary sources also. And through this collection of data, we are satisfying the objectives of research. And then we are making further recommendations so that these recommendations can be implemented and the problems can be resolved. So in simple terms, we can say that research is basically a step-by-step process through which we are trying to find out solutions for our problem. Now, today, at this hour, we are studying what is research in respect to management. So, more importantly, we need to understand what is a business research. So, again, a very simple definition can be that a systematic inquiry that provides information to guide managerial decisions. Why? Because over here, we are more concerned with solving the management issues. And who is going to solve the management issues? These are the managers who will solve the managerial issues. And for them to give them relevant data, we normally do a research. So business research is a systematic inquiry that will help to provide sufficient data to a manager where he or she can use that particular data in order to resolve the business problems that they are facing. The next term is research concept. And over here, if you can see, I've written research concept. In brackets, I have written single variable, or construct. In bracket, I have written multiple variables. So basically, concept is what? It is a generalized idea about a class of objects, attributes, occurrences, or procedures that has been given a name. Basically, concept is something which we know, fine, and the objects, the attributes, something which based on which we are doing some research. For example, concepts are basically the building blocks of the theory. Like in organizational theory, we normally read leadership theories. We know what is leadership. So leadership is a concept. Morale, it is a concept. Productivity, it is a concept. Then in finance, we normally know GNP. So this is a concept. This we use in our daily life, and we try to resolve our problems through it. Then we take inflation. Inflation is also a concept. Risk, it is also a concept. So basically, concept is something which we know very well and based on which we normally, solve a problem or we identify some issues and then we are getting our problems resolved. Now, a basic difference between concept and construct is that concept can be evaluated. When we are doing a research, we normally don't go for the concept. We go for the study of the variable. Fine. Variable is something whose value is changing. So when we study only one variable, by studying only one variable, when we can go and study a concept, when we are studying a concept using just one variable, it is called a concept. And when we are dealing with a concept where we have to study various variables, more than one variables, and then cumulatively we are understanding a concept, over there the term construct is used. So in very simple terms, when we are studying only one variable, we are talking about a concept. When we are studying more than one variables to understand something, so that understanding is about the construct. Then the next relevant topic or the terminology that we normally study under research methodology is research propositions. So these are statements concerned with the relationships among the concepts. Now, when we go for a study, we normally try to correlate some concepts. So the relationships between those concepts is normally what we understand by saying propositions. These explain the logical linkage among certain concepts by asserting a universal connection between the concepts. So basically, this connection between the concepts is the propositions. So for example, a good managerial behavior ascertains loyalty by employees. So by saying this, we can say that when the managerial behavior is good, the employees will get motivated and they will show loyalty towards the management. So this is a proposition that, okay, fine, there are two different concepts in this. Number one is the managerial behavior and the other one is the loyalty of the employee. So these are two different concepts. And these two different concepts, we are, you know, showing the relationship between them, that when there is good managerial behavior, then only there will be loyalty by the employees. So this relationship is called research propositions. The next and the very important terminology that we normally use in research methodology is hypothesis. What is hypothesis? So hypothesis is a formal statement explaining some output. It is an assumption or a guess. Basically, when we go for a researcher, before executing the research, he or she assumes something, assumes a result for his or her research. So that statement, that formal statement that defines the assumption taken by the researcher before executing the research is the research hypothesis. It is basically an assumption or a guess that a person is making. It is not very much fixed, or it is not such that the assumption should always be true. This he or she tries to explore through his or her research whether the assumption that he or she has taken in the beginning is true or not. So this is what the research is all about. The research, basically hypothesis, tries to keep the research on track. So now, for example, a sales manager can make hypothesis or can hypothesize that a salesperson with highest product knowledge will be most productive. So this is what a sales manager, before going on for a research, he or she can hypothesize, can assume that the salesperson with the highest knowledge will be the most productive one. This is what he's thinking in the beginning of the research. Or a marketing manager can hypothesize that a positive customer attitude will produce a growth in the sales. That when the customer has a positive attitude, definitely the sales will increase. So a marketing manager will assume that. So hypothesis is basically a formal statement of an unproven proposition that is empirically testable. So over here, some terms are to be highlighted. Number one, it is a formal statement. Yes, we have already stated that. Then this statement is unproven. Why it is unproven? Because we are studying, or we are, you know, assuming this statement before, you know, conducting the research. So it is an unproven proposition. And how we are going to prove this? We are going to prove this in an empirical form. So normally for empirical researchers, you know, we take the hypothesis into consideration. Hence, hypothesis is written in a proper way so that it can be supported or shown to be wrong through an empirical. It can be supported means it is proved, or shown to be wrong, that is, we are rejecting it through an empirical test. So basically, there is a proper way of writing it, and at the end of the research, with the help of the data that we have collected, we try to judge whether the hypothesis that we took was accepted, or are we supporting the hypothesis, or we are proving it wrong, that is, we are rejecting the hypothesis. And how we are going to do this? We're going to do this by way of testing it. And we normally go for different tests for that. And we normally say that we are empirically testing the hypothesis. Hypothesis over here, I want to make a differentiation for you that when we are using hypothesis, only one hypothesis is there. We normally say hypothesis, that is with SIS. And when we talk about more than one hypothesis, we normally use the spelling as SES. So this was something which students of research should know. Now, the next is, there are two types of hypothesis. Normally, we write both the forms. The first hypothesis is the null hypothesis, which is normally denoted by H0. And H0 or the null hypothesis means no difference hypothesis. Meaning thereby, for example, if I take this example, a website with a blue background will generate equal sales as that by an identical website with a red background. I'm repeating it again. A website with a blue background will generate equal sales as that by an identical website with a red background, meaning thereby that there will be no difference. There will be no difference in a website which is of a blue background and which is of a red background. Both will have equal sales. There will be no difference based on the background the website is having. This is a null hypothesis because there is no difference in both the results. Both are on the equal platform. And the other hypothesis, just opposite to the null hypothesis, is the alternate hypothesis, which is normally denoted by H1 or HA also. So the alternate hypothesis is just opposite to the null hypothesis. So in the previous one, if we have taken that there is no difference, the alternate will be there is a difference. Now, what can be the difference? The difference can be that the blue background website might generate a higher sale or it might generate a lower sale. So, how we can write it? A website with a blue background will not generate equal sales as that by an identical website with a red background. So it is very simple to state that it will not produce both the websites, they are not producing equal sales. So there is a difference in that. So this is the alternate hypothesis. Now there is one more thing in this. We can even mention over here, the researcher has not mentioned whether which color website will generate a higher sale or a lower sale. This has not been mentioned in it. It is just stated that they will not produce the same results. Okay. So this hypothesis can be stated in some other forms also. Like here, it should be noted that we have used the term not equal sales, which means that the sales can be less than or more than. Hence, such hypothesis is two-tailed in nature, as the result can lie in any of the direction. So basically, why I'm mentioning two-tailed over here is that for such hypothesis, when the when nothing is mentioned about the result, to which direction the result will lie, the result can go in any of the directions. So over there, we normally go for two-tailed tests. So over here, it can be understood in a way that such hypotheses are two-tailed because the result can be can go in any of the directions. And just opposite to that, if I use the term less than, equal to, or more than equal to, or less than, or just more than. So if I am using terms like this, then the result will go into one direction. And over there, we can say that the tests or the hypothesis is unidirectional, or it is one directional or one tailed. So with an example, I would like to let you know that a website with a blue background will generate less sales as compared to an identical website with a red background. So over here, the blue background website will generate less sales in comparison to the red one. So this can be, this means we are talking about one side of the thing, one side of the scale. Or it can be in the other way around, we can say that, or a website with a blue background will not generate more sales as that by an identical website with a red background. So in this way, I just want to let you know that here the result lies in only one direction. Hence, the hypothesis is called one-tailed hypothesis. So basically, hypothesis is a formal statement that we are proving, right? And hypothesis, when we are framing the hypothesis, when we are writing the hypothesis, there are basically two formats of writing it. The null hypothesis is H0 hypothesis, which normally is a no difference hypothesis. That means the variables that we are taking into consideration, the results will not differ. Both the groups or both the variables will have the same results. So that is the null hypothesis, and the alternate hypothesis is one with a difference, right? And when we are having no differentiation, when the answer can go into both the directions, we normally say a two-tailed hypothesis is there, and we test those hypotheses using two-tailed tests. And when we are talking about unidirectional, one-directional, we normally go for one-tailed hypothesis, and the tests that we use are one-tailed tests. Then another very important concept is population or the universe. So the complete group of entities under study is a population. Fine. A population shares some common sets of characteristics. So normally we can say, if I'm making a study on Rajasthan, then the whole of Rajasthan, the citizens of Rajasthan would be the population or the universe for me, fine? Then what is population element? It refers to individual member of the population. So say if you and I, we are the citizens of Rajasthan. So each one entity of Rajasthan, each citizen of Rajasthan would be the population element. Now, population can be of two types. It can be finite and it can be infinite. Finite population is one in which the number of population elements are known. Fine. And infinite population is one in which the total number of all the population elements is unknown. That is, when you know that in your population you have, say, 1 crore people. So if you are able to make a mark, and if you are justified on this part, that how many people together will constitute your population, you can say that it is a finite population. And when we are unknown about the number of the people, number of the entities in a population, we say that we normally don't know the population, so we normally say it is an infinite population. Now, why it is very important for a researcher to know all these concepts? It is because that whatever tests we will apply, empirically. I'm talking about empirical researchers basically, because over here my focus is business research, and normally business researchers or the academic researchers that we do, they are normally empirical researchers. So basically empirical researchers, the base for empirical research are tests. And these tests are applied. How will you identify that? Okay, fine. This is the test that will be the apt test for my research. So over there, all these things are very important. You should know what is the characteristic of a population. You should know how you have done the sampling and what is your hypothesis all about. How you have taken the hypothesis, how you have framed the hypothesis. All these concepts are really very important. So a finite population is one in which you know the number of the population units, and if you don't know the number of the population elements or the units, you will say that this is an infinite population. Now, when we are studying the whole of the population, when you are conducting a research, and if you have got time and energy and financially, if you are strong enough, then you can study each and every person. Then you can take the feedback of each and every person. You can interview each and every person in a population element. And then you can come out to a result. Okay, fine. My research is concluding this result. So when we are studying the whole of the population, we normally say this is a census survey. So every 10 years, the government of India goes for a census, and each one of us, the details, all the demographic details, education and everything is taken by the government. And then the government, you know, makes some report, and some things are like structured. Okay, fine. India is having this frame now. Fine. So that is the census. Census is an investigation made on all the individual elements of the population. But normally when we go for business researches, for academic researches, this is not possible for us, because there is a time limit into which we have to do all these researches. So normally we go for another type of researches in which we select a sample out of it. A representative sample is taken out of a population. We study the sample, and the results that we draw out of a sample, we then say, okay, fine, the result of a sample is this. So the result of the population would be this. So we normally go for sample, and a sample is a subset or some part of the larger population. So the population is the complete group of entities that we are studying. Population element is one individual. All individual members of a population are called individual population element. A population can be finite when we know the number of the people or the number of the entities that we are studying. It will be a finite population. When we don't know the number, it will be an infinite population. When we are studying whole, each and every population element, we normally say we are going for a census survey. And when we take a representative sample or a group of people out of that population and make a study on those that particular group, we say it is a sample survey. For example, a study on analytical skills of students pursuing professional education of Rajasthan. If someone has to do, say I have to do a research on the analytical skills of students, those who are pursuing professional education in Rajasthan. So first I should know how many students are there in the whole of Rajasthan who are pursuing professional education. So all those students who would be pursuing professional education in Rajasthan would be my population. So the total students pursuing professional education in Rajasthan, say the number of students is 10,000. So this 10,000 would be my population or the universe. And say this is 10,000, I'm making a figure over here. I can give a figure over here. So when I'm giving a figure over here, this is an arbitrary figure. This is an example given to you. So if I can say that there are 10,000 students who are pursuing professional education in Rajasthan, so this is a finite population. And when I'm not able to know that how many students are there, I don't know how many students are there who are pursuing professional education in Rajasthan, I will say that my population is infinite in nature. Now, it is not possible for me, if I'm studying all these 10,000 students, if I'm making a study on all these 10,000 students, and if I'm evaluating the analytical skills of each and every student out of these 10,000, I will say that I'm going for a census study. But normally, as I told you, it is not possible for us to study the whole of the population. So we will select a sample out of it. And say I have selected 1,000 students out of these 10,000, then this 1,000, the group of these 1,000 students would be my sample. So I think through this example, it is quite clear to you that what is a sample, what is a census, what is population, what is universe, and what is a finite population, and what is an infinite population. So let's move on to some other terminology. So one term that is normally which we encounter with is parameter. Parameter is a statistical value related to a population. For example, if I study the mean of the 10,000 students that were under study, I will say that the mean of those 10,000 students is a parameter, because that statistical value is related to the population. Mean of the IQ level of all the 10,000 students would be a parameter. So parameters related to a population, the statistical value of a population. On the other way around, what is a statistic? A statistic is a statistical value related to a sample. Fine. So if I'm taking the mean of the IQ level of the 1,000 students that I've taken a sample of, if I calculate the mean of those 1,000 students, I will say that the figure or the value that I will draw, I will say that is a statistic. So this research student should be very clear of that when we are talking about a statistical value of a population, it is called parametric and parameter. And when I'm talking about a statistical value of a sample, it is a statistic. So there is a difference between parameter and statistic. So I hope this video was of interest to you. Stay tuned with us so that we can benefit you with more informative videos like this. Tune us through our YouTube channel. Thank you so very much.